invite the administration to join us. Meeting of the Constitutional Affairs Panel. We have a quorum and it's now time. And joining us is Mr. Chen Ka-lok for the first time. It should be Yeung Ngok-kiu. He has asked, Mr. Chen has asked a question. First item of agenda, information documents issued since last time. There's a letter from the Secretary for Constitutional and Mainland Affairs on date for the general election for the 6th Legislative Council, and there's also a letter from Mr. Chen Ka-lok and one from Mr. Alvin Yeung. Mr. Yeung, now both Mr. Chen and I wish to ask questions in relation to the loss of ballot box in the Ma'anshan by-elections. Now, you can have two opportunities to speak on this. First occasion is item number 4 on the agenda today, and there is also a discussion later on the practical arrangements for the 2016 general elections. So, that is concerning the guidelines issued by the EAC. Now, those guidelines are in relation to the election activities, whereas we are now targeting the management of the EAC. If you think it's suitable, I will ask the questions when we come to that topic. I think it's okay if you discuss it then, because it's quite a wide topic. Now, Mr. Alvin Yeung asked to discuss this, and you suggest that this can be discussed at agenda item number 4. Now, I agree with that, but you don't require a response. Well, usually if it's a written letter, then it's a written response should be forthcoming. Maybe they say they don't have enough information. Well, it depends on the answer. If the answer satisfies you, then there wouldn't be need for a written reply. Well, sometimes the answers are not that up to par. Item number 2, items for discussion at the next meeting. The Undersecretary is with us. Let us know what you wish to bring to us next time. The 2016 general election of LegCo will be on the 4th of September. The EAC and REO are actively preparing for it. Now, we will brief you on the proposed guidelines to changes, and we also propose that at the next meeting we have two items in relation to this topic as well. First is the practical arrangements for the 2016 LegCo general elections, and secondly, regarding the elections, we will have a series of publicity activities, and we will brief members on the publicity program. Good. I think we are both concerned about these two items. Ms. Emily Lau? Well, I have no problem with these two topics, the voters registration will also be on that date, will be on the same date, so please let us have a report on that, because we are concerned on that. Let's also have a discussion on the new chairman of the Equal Opportunity Commission, Professor Chen. Now, he hasn't a lot of record to show on that area of work. Now, there's not much we can do. He has been appointed. When can we have a discussion with him? It seems that he is not very positive in replying to our questions. Now, he will only come on the job on the 11th of April. I think we will let him settle down in his new position. What do you propose? Now, in mid-July, our term will end. There will be no meeting from mid-July. We have May and June. Now, it depends on the administration. Maybe it's May or June. I think there can be better preparation if it's June. Now, many human rights organizations and equal opportunity organizations would like to meet the new chairman. Can you allow more time for the discussion? Let's look at the agenda at that time. Now, we will forward the views to the EOC, and we will then inform members when the new chairman can come and brief us on his work. Yes, the EOC chairman comes every year to talk, to chat with us, to report on his work. Chairman, you are right. So when will he come to tell us about this work? I think there's a lot of to be discussed. Now, this will be a new term. Well, perhaps both the new and old chairman can come. Well, it's not much point in getting the old chairman to come. Why not the old chairman? Well, it's very rare for both the new and old chairman to come. Well, you can do something new. People say you are very innovative. Well, I am quite impervious to praises. Item number three, the Electoral Affairs Commission report on the 2015 District Council ordinary election. Now, the report has been issued to you, and there are two documents. One is CB bracket 2185/15/16/03 by the government, and 04 document background brief prepared by the Electoral Secretariat. Now, with us today, there will be the Undersecretary, and there will be Mr. Gordon Leung, Deputy Secretary for Constitutional Mainland Affairs, and there will also be Mr. Lee Pak Hong, Chief Electoral Officer of the REO, and Ms. Candy Ma, Principal Election Officer of the REO. Perhaps the Undersecretary can brief us on the document. Now, the ordinary election was held on 22nd of November last year. The EAC, in accordance with the legislation, has submitted a report to the CE. This shows how the EAC conducted and supervised the 2015 ordinary election and sets out a detailed account of future improvements. Based on the recent experience. Now, we thank the EAC for holding the election in accordance with the law and for making a review. We welcome the recommendations for improvements in the report. And now I will invite the Chief Electoral Officer, Mr. Lee, to brief us. Now, we have already published, released the report on the ordinary elections. This shows how the EAC has supervised the election, and it details the arrangements concerning the election. Now, overall, the EAC is satisfied that the election was held in an open, fair, and honest manner, and we are also concerned that there are matters of public concern. There are some areas that can be further improved, and the recommendations are in Chapter 13 of the report. Now, some observations relate to the difficulty to identify suitable venues at polling stations. Now, we have in this elections set up 495 ordinary polling stations. Now, we've always had difficulties in identifying these polling stations. So early that is back in late 2014, we already started trying to find these venues, but we came across difficulties, especially when we asked the schools. So in March 2015, we wrote to some school sponsoring bodies calling for their active help to make available their school premises. A lot of these bodies have responded positively, but a small number of them were for various reasons unable to let us use their premises. Now, in Hong Kong, this is a difficult issue, so the EAC calls upon the school sponsoring bodies and other public organizations and health institutions to assist in this matter.
We also have to closely liaise with the EOC with regard to polling arrangements in order to provide more facilities, in particular for those with mobility problems, so that they can have more choices. During the 2015 DC ordinary election, out of the 495 polling stations, 465 would provide easy access to those with mobility problems, so that would account for a very high percentage, that is 94%. We will continue to identify suitable polling stations for those with mobility problems. But then, given Hong Kong's geographical situation, there might be some difficulties. We have also set out that we have invoked CAP 542, Section 32, Subsection 3, with regard to 170 electors or voters' inaccurate information. We have rectified that so as to ensure that they will be able to exercise their voting rights during the polling day. We understand that the ERO will make such corrections to the registration particulars in accordance with the law, and that is indisputable. But then we believe that some improvement measures should be adopted, and there should also be more cross-checking of address information with other government departments to ensure the correctness of the information. Moreover, the REO is also promoting the online voter information inquiry system, which has been launched since 2014, so that electors can notify the REO in time for correction of any discrepancies found during their inspection of the registration particulars. We have also noticed that there are a couple of polling stations which require longer time for counting because of one reason or another. But then most polling stations have been able to complete the counting procedure within 4.5 hours. This is slightly longer than the 4 hours required in the previous election. That has to do with the increase in the electorate. For example, in the 2015 DC ordinary election, in terms of the number of voters and also the voting rate is higher than the previous election. We will continue to identify ways of improving the speed and efficiency in order to announce the results as soon as possible. Apart from that, as regards other observations and recommendations, they have been enclosed in Annex 1. That's all I'd like to say. If there are any further questions, I'll be more than happy to provide that. Any questions from members? I'll read out the order. Emily Lau, Claudia Mo, Alvin Yeung, Kenneth Chen, and Christopher Cheung. Anyone else? Okay, so 4 minutes each. Emily Lau. Thank you, Chairman. A couple of points. Work on the polling stations. As I've said many, many times, I think you should try to identify locations which are conveniently located, so that you will also have to impose on them so that they would work with you. All right, on this occasion, it's only 4.7%. I believe that that's already very low. So the turnout rate was 47%. I believe that that has to do with some of the polling stations being inaccessible. So I don't really, I'm not advocating that you should legislate in order to make it a statutory power to turn these premises into polling stations. But then in how many places where voters have not been able to cast their votes for whatever reason? So do you have the records? I haven't really read the details here. And also, certainly, it took you 4.5 hours to count the votes. I think this is outrageous, Chairman. We are not talking about a large number of votes. Have you been to Taiwan? Well, as soon as they close the polling station, and then it would take them just an hour or so to complete the counting. So how come it took you 4.5 hours? So is there any way for you to shorten the counting time? Yes, Mr. Lee, concerning identifying suitable venues as polling stations, I think there are many objective problems. For example, in identifying suitable venues, there are several factors. Number one, it should be conveniently located. That's the first and foremost consideration. Second, there should be sufficient space within the polling stations for us to operate. So in identifying suitable venues, we also have to look into that. And thirdly, we hope that the polling stations would be convenient to the elders and also those with mobility difficulties. That's why in determining if a venue is suitable, we have to take care of that as well. In the past, as you might be aware, most of the polling stations would be in private premises. For example, according to our experience in the past, let's say during the DC election in November last year, we have 495 polling stations. Most of them are in private premises, including schools and also local organizations, premises, and so on. So even if we try to rent or hire a place, we have to get the consent from the owner of the premises. Of course, we hope that including the school sponsoring bodies and so on, they would cooperate with us, yet we can only try our best because it depends on whether or not the organizer or the landowner is able to hire the premises to us, because very often we will have to hire the premises for more than one day, because we will have to do it on two consecutive Sundays, and they will have to let us decorate the polling station on the previous day. That's why we have to get a lot of help from the owner of the premises. So we will continue to liaise with the relevant bodies, and also the EAC chairman was also very concerned that because he also wrote to some school sponsors on that, and that has been effective because some school sponsors have given us a very positive response afterwards. And therefore, in the upcoming elections, we will have to make use of those venues as well, so we will try our best. For those who have not been able to cast their votes, well, on the polling day, we have received some inquiries from voters or members of the public. They have also asked us how come after they have gone to the polling station, they have not been able to cast their votes. In many cases, we try to verify their registration particulars, but then during our previous cycles, we have also conducted inquiry exercises, and on those occasions, they have already been taken out from the final register, and therefore, these voters might have been voters in past elections, but then they might have been disqualified. That's why we will have to help them so that they can re-register to become eligible voters. Well, have you got the figures? We haven't got the statistics, and the EAC is now dealing with complaints. When we have the figures, we will come and report to you. Chairman, can I continue to talk about the counting time? Well, on the issue of counting, majority of the polling stations took 4.5 hours to complete the counting. Well, that's comparable to previous exercises. As I said, in 2011, the DC election took about 4 hours, but then on this occasion, the voter turnout was slightly higher. That's why I think that explains why it took us longer. And also in terms of the vote counting and also the verification procedure, there are some necessary procedures to follow. Of course, we will try our best to shorten it, and we'll see if there are further room for shortening the time. I also note Ms. Emily Lau referred to the Taiwan election, but then please understand that they completed the voting at 4 p.m. and then by 8 or 9 p.m. they would be able to release the initial results. In fact, the procedures are more or less the same, but then in Taiwan, the voting would take place in many more polling stations, and therefore the number of electorate that they had to serve in each and every polling station would be somewhat smaller. That's why we have to understand that there are different arrangements in place for different places. Ms. Claudia Mo, I'd like to know that in the introduction, item D, you said that there would be introduction to the candidates, and on one occasion, because the introduction by the candidate was in fundamental conflict with the basic law. That's why you asked him to change the details, and he refused. So you said that you have considered legal advice, and of course I think that would refer to the DFJ's advice. So you said that there was fundamental conflict. What's the definition? Is it that next time if I still insist on saying very much the same thing, but then if the wording is less direct, if I can be a little more vague, or if I can be a little more ambivalent, then I'll be able to make it? Because what's unsettling is that apparently there is some political vetting involved. That's what worries me. And the second question is, all right, as the EAC might have noticed, all right, if I have people with four surnames in my flat, then there would be complaints, and I would be in trouble. But then the most important thing is when I go to the court, well, why can't you just send somebody to my flat, and then you can find out that my mother-in-law and also my in-laws are staying with me, so that in the process, for the one being complained against, before he has to go to court, why can't you do something to verify the particulars? So can that be done? Yes, Mr. Lee. Well, in the report, Ms. Claudia Mo also referred to a particular case. So let me attempt to explain the reason and what actually happened. In fact, in every election, we would issue a paper called Introduction to the Candidates, and we'll send that out to the voters, and that would register the substance of the manifesto of the candidates. So that's the arrangement in the past too. So this is an administrative arrangement, and in the guidelines it says that the introduction to candidates will have to be in order. There must not be any unlawful substance included in the leaflet. So that's the nature of that. Last year, during the election of the DC, a candidate, as mentioned here, he submitted a sample of what he's going to send out to his voters, and we noticed that there was a wording referring to Hong Kong founding its own nation. So it says that Hong Kong can found its own nation. So these are the words contained in the leaflet. And as you understand it, in a community, with regard to whether Hong Kong can become a nation on its own or a sovereign state, all right, if somebody introduces himself as a LegCo candidate, he said that Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong and Hong Kong people making or determining their own fate. Is that okay? All right, it's up to the candidates to publicize themselves in the process of electioneering. But then for this particular leaflet, is to be printed out by the EAC and sent out. So it involves the use of government resources, and therefore our long-standing practice and policy is that when it comes to government resources and government organizations, no illegal acts will be tolerated. That's why on this particular case, we have also consulted the DFJ's advice. All right, I understand that you're worried or disturbed by the wording founding its own nation. All right, what if it's about Hong Kong people determining their own fate? Would you have problems with that? Well, I'm not going to comment on particular wording, because we have to look at the wording in its context as to what is spelled out in the entire text, instead of just interpreting a particular word or term. Because even for the EAC, it would not just be looking at the wording per se, it would be looking at the wording in the context of the publicity materials. And also I have to emphasize that in this particular case, the EAC is not a court. The REO is not a court either. We are not saying that the wording is problematic, but then once we got this, if it's to be published by a government department and sent out by a government department, then it would involve it might involve an illegal act, and therefore the REO, as a government department using government resources, it should not be assisting or aiding an illegal act. That's why we have asked the candidate to revise his wording. So we have asked the candidate to revise the wording, and if he refuses to do so, then we would just be sending out the leaflet without the wording. So they have they have full autonomy in this, so it has nothing to do with freedom of speech. There is no political consideration whatsoever. Yes, Alvin Yeung, thank you. I'd like to follow up on the direction adopted by Ms. Mo in her questions. I'd like the EAC to elaborate a little bit on this. So the government's stance is that you don't really understand the wording. You don't know if it's illegal, but then you've consulted the DFJ, and the DFJ's advice is that it might be problematic. That's why you made a decision and you exercise your discretion to refuse to do the postage for this candidate. Is that the case? So can you confirm that?
Is my understanding correct, Mr. Lee? Now, based on the legal opinion that we received, this content may possibly be in connection, in relation to a law infringing behavior. Now, you agreed with Ms. Mo that you are not a court. It's just suspected of being law infringing, right, Mr. Lee? That's correct? So, suspected of law infringing, that can cover a lot of things. Is there any objective standard? Now, our decisions will be based on the legal opinion from the DOJ. So in future, candidates, well, as you said, you don't have any objective standard. Every time you have to submit to the DOJ for review. So before a candidate submits his platform to you, he does not have a clear guideline on what he can say or what he can't. Now, if any candidate has any question on any part of his platform, he can have the freedom to seek his own legal opinion. But as a government department, we have an objective standard. That is, if we receive some wording that very likely will be law infringing, then this department or any other government department should not associate itself with it. Now, I'd like to clarify about the logic. Now, the government says this is suspected to be law infringing, not yet law infringing. Now, you say you have an objective standard, so every time it's based on the legal opinion from the DOJ, so you don't have an objective standard. Do you agree? Chairman, I think I can exercise my discretion in using my time, so I'd like to ask shorter questions. So why don't you finish your entire question? Mr. Lee, I'm not a lawyer. I can only repeat and say that we do have an objective standard, and that is we get the legal opinion from the DOJ. Let me try to approach from another perspective. When the candidate submits this document that he hopes to be sent by mail, and you get the legal DOJ's opinion. Now, we know there is a deadline for mailing. Now, can you guarantee that there will be more time for the candidates to make amendments? Because when you are close to the cutoff dates, there may be little time for the candidate to make the amendment. Now, Mr. Alvin Yeung, I think, is talking about another case. Now, in the 2015 DC election, that case was about the publication of the candidates' introductions. But there's a cutoff date, right? Yes, there's certainly a deadline for the submission of the draft, because there's only about 4 weeks before the polling day, so there have to be many arrangements. So we have to print the introductions to candidates and then mailing out the candidates. I will continue in the second round. Mr. Chen Ka-lok, it's a free election, so it should be the voter who makes the decision. Now, the REO seems to be very objective, talking about legal opinion, but you are undertaking political vetting. but he wouldn't admit it. Now, the housing department vets the posters, LCSD vets the dramas. Now, that person graduated from the National University of Taiwan, and he took away the word national, and so on. So this all this is political vetting. You don't want the government to be embarrassed, so you use the legal opinion from the DOJ as an excuse. Let me ask you, building a nation or country in Hong Kong, where how is that against the law? Now, the words building a country in Hong Kong, according to the legal opinion, that's infringing of the Article 1 of the Basic Law, that is, Hong Kong is a innate part of the inseparable part of the People's Republic of China. Mr. Paul Chair, please do not try to comment behind me. Now, I'm talking about a free elections. It depends on the candidate how he wants to explain his own political platform and beliefs. Why is it that the government has to do this kind of vetting, has to do this kind of cleansing? Now, you say building a country, that's not a wording that can be used. And so you are gradually tightening the guidelines, so people has less and less freedom. So you have started a precedent. Other government departments take after you in doing this kind of political vetting. So many electors cannot be communicated, receive communications of this nature. So you take the legal opinion and you use this as your, you rely on this to redact or remove wording not amenable to you. Well, he has already explained, but you can explain again. Now, as I understand Mr. Chen's concern, now during elections, the candidates should have a lot of freedom to explain his own beliefs, and it's important that this continues. However, for taking part in public elections, whether it's in district council or legislative elections, every candidate has to take an oath that he has to support the basic law. Now, if he tries to raise a point that may be in conflict with the basic law, we have to seek legal opinion from the DOJ. So we have no political vetting motive. We just look at the law. Making a declaration is a legal requirement. Now, if we receive a legal opinion that such content or such behavior might be infringing of the basic law, then, well, it would be difficult for me to understand why a government department should not act according to the legal opinion. We should be very cautious that the government departments are slowly reducing the room for political freedom through this kind of packaging. Now, we are talking about free choice, free elections by the electorate. The government should not do the vetting for the electorate. Mr. Christopher Cheung, now in the report, I see that there's a difficulty in identifying in suitable venues. Of course, a venue close to where people live, that would be ideal, and that would raise the voting rate. Now, the report mentioned that in the 2015 DC election, now they have to be 273 schools were approached, but not that many schools responded positively. Now, how does this percentage compare with previous years? Have you studied why this, so many schools were unable to make their premises available for polling stations? Polling stations, Mr. Lee. Now, I think in every election, there are about 50 or 60% of the polling stations located in schools. The reason is that many of these schools are quite centrally located and they are quite spacious. So they are suitable as polling stations. Now, in the past, during every election, we liaise closely with the schools. Very early on, we liaise with them, telling them that there will be an election coming up. We hope to borrow their premises. Now, in the 2015 ordinary DC election, we started the work in late 2014 already. But the schools have their own activities. Very often, they schedule them very early on for a certain weekend. Now, if these activities have been arranged beforehand, the schools have their own difficulties. So we have to try to accommodate and coordinate with each other. Now, at REO, we try to approach them early and we try to accommodate their wishes. Now, schools are always our first choices in the districts because the school premises are well located and are quite spacious. So we will continue to work towards that. Chairman, now, could it be that the work done after the premises are used for polling stations, that work has been inadequate so that the schools have reservations? And have we tried to visit the schools afterwards to try to show the sincerity of the authorities? I thank Mr. Cheung for his reminders. Now, after every election, we need to do some work after the elections, for instance, in cleaning. Sometimes there are minor damages. For instance, in the working of the polling stations, we have to hang up or paste up certain objects. So very often, there may be a little damage done. Now, these are usually very slight, and usually after the event, we will arrange for some repair works to be done. Now, for polling stations in the past, firstly, we will use phone calls, and necessary, we will visit the school sponsoring body or the school principal to try to convey to them what we need. Next, Ms. Dari Lee. The candidates have the freedom to publicize their beliefs, but freedom is not unlimited. If the contents of the publicity is clearly against the laws of Hong Kong or even the Constitution, then the REO is correct in seeking legal opinion and acting accordingly. Now, very often, there have been unfair reports on candidates. Now, we are now talking about DC elections. Now, during the elections, some media, well, the REO, the ICAC have been vetting accusations of vote rigging. Now, how are you coming along in the findings? And often in DC elections, there have been many complaints that some potential candidates, their their addresses have been changed or amended to a phantom address. So have you anything that you can report? And also the vote counting in New Territories East by elections is very unsatisfactory. It took several hours. It appears that there was a problem with the key of the ballot box. Now, can you shorten the counting time in the future? Now, all the workers and all the candidates go through a very long process. If that can be reduced, and if you can employ science and technology in that effort, it can be good for everybody concerned.
So my question is, during the polling process, so with regard to the checking of the voter register and so on, have you introduced the latest science and technology and so on? And many voters also have this doubt. That is, when he goes to a polling station and if he has failed to register as a voter in other places, what would they do? Or if he goes to the wrong polling station? Well, some actually complained to me saying that they had no idea as to where he should go to cast his vote. So with advancement in technology, have you reviewed the current arrangement so that in terms of the use of science and technology at the polling stations, are you able to catch up with the latest state-of-the-art technology? Mr. Lee, concerning the issue of vote rigging, during the last voter registration exercise, we received some complaints claiming that there were vote rigging instances or situations, and we would refer to the police for investigation. But then before we did that, we would always do our own initial check first. And in most cases, according to our understanding, the relevant voter has already moved to a new address without remembering to notify the REO. So I don't think that should be regarded as vote rigging per se. And of course, there are some cases that are being investigated by the police, and therefore I dare not say what the conclusion of those cases is, because according to some press reports, none of those cases has been substantiated. Is that right? Well, as far as I'm aware, none of the cases has been substantiated so far. But of course, we will have to wait until after the police have completed their investigation, and only after they have concluded their investigation, if there is a substantiated case, then usually the normal procedure would be for them to take up prosecution. And there was a village election last week, and somebody provided false information, and he was prosecuted, and as a result, he was sentenced to jail. And mention was also made about address details being tampered with. And after the completion of the voter registration exercise last time, we also received 200 plus complaints about this, and the relevant voters said that they did not make such an amendment application, but then the particulars were changed, and therefore there was discrepancy with the actual information, and we have asked the police to follow on those cases as in a form of criminal investigation. We haven't got any further details yet. We will have to wait until after the police have completed their investigation. And one point is also related to this one, is the NT East by-election. Ms. Dari Lee also referred to the case of the lost ballot box key. And on different occasions, the EAC also refer to this, and an investigation would be launched on this, and in a future EAC report, this case would be referred to. So I don't intend to give a very detailed account or supplement on this right now, but then I'd like to take the opportunity to say that with regard to the closing of the ballot box arrangements, I'd like to clarify that, because apparently there have been a lot of speculations in the community which might not be entirely correct. Well, in every election, as you might be aware, we would prepare the ballot boxes, and before the ballot box is used, the returning officer would point to the candidates or their regions where the ballot box would be, and then the doors or the box would be closed in front of these candidates and agents. So there would be two arrangements. Number one, the key would be hung to the lid of the box, and there would also be a box closure certificate, and the returning officer at each polling station would sign on that paper, and the candidate and the agent would also be signing on that, and two witnesses would also be required to sign on it, and then a rope would also be hung onto that, and the rope would also be sealed. So when you look at whether or not a box has been tampered with, you will have to find out if the rope has been cut or tampered with. So even if the key was there, so there is no chance that you can take away the key without removing the seal and the tape on it. But then on this occasion, those were not damaged at all. And the chairman of the EAC has also made it clear after the election that on that occasion, the returning officer also confirmed that the box was never tampered with. The box was stationed in the polling station throughout the election, and it was also monitored by police officers present, and therefore there was no evidence to show that the ballot box was ever tampered with. And therefore, in those circumstances, the box was open, and that's in line with our long-standing arrangements. And of course, what happened that night was that it took us a lot of time to deal with the incident, and we are looking into that so that in future, where similar instances happen, we will decide how we're going to deal with that. Alright, you have overrun on your time. Li Chek Yen, you said that none of the cases has been substantiated, but then according to the report, is one of the cases involved a large-scale incident. Alright, so in one of the housing estates, voters admitted that they had accepted gifts, and the number amounted to some 41, and that involved a DAP candidate. And of course, you will have to investigate. But then on your part, have you looked into the 41 cases? Did they really live in Shek Lei Estate? It should have been very easy, because they should have appeared in public housing estate's residence list. And of course, public housing residents could have bought their own private property. But then if they have rented the private property, there should have been tenancy agreement receipts. But then there are two people who are supposedly public housing tenants, and yet they have allowed 41 people to be registered in the same address. And here we have this Mr. Kwok from the DAP, and he also complained to the housing department, and then a particular list was removed. So on the vote rigging cases, well, you said that none of the cases has been substantiated so far, but then what about you? What about you? Have you conducted your own investigation into those? Mr. Lee? Yes, Mr. Lee referred to a particular case, and we were aware of that. We have also got hold of some information with us, but then please bear with us. That is how, in investigating the case, there are two parts. Number one, for the REO, we are responsible for voter registration, so for whatever we have in our hands. So we'll see if that voter is an eligible voter, and as Mr. Lee said, it involves a public housing estate. We knew it very well, and therefore the relevant information has been passed on to the police for further investigation, because if somebody filed false information, that's criminal in nature. So it's a criminal offense, and therefore we will have to leave that to the police, so the police would be conducting their own investigation with such information. And on our part, we have to verify the eligibility of the voter. If the voter is not able to verify his own address, then according to the existing procedure, he will be disqualified. Then of course, we would be doing that outside of the criminal investigation. We would not be interfering with police's criminal investigation. So what did you do? All right, it says that there are 41 voters, so they should be living in Shek Lei, but then they went to Tai Pak Tin. So did they register back with Shek Lei or what? So what happened to these voters? Well, we did check their eligibility. But of course, as it involves the particulars of individual voters, I don't intend to disclose them here. So we have worked on it. But then I'm not asking for their details. So for the 41 voters, so after the verification, did they all go back to Shek Lei? Or half of them went back to Shek Lei and then half of them remained in Tai Pak Tin? I'm asking for numbers only. I'm not asking for their particulars. Mr. Lee, well, I can only say that, well, for the voters involved, we will have to follow the latest particulars that they have furnished with us so that, for example, in the upcoming voter registration exercise, we will have the initial voter register and we will try to verify that. Again, you're dodging the issue. It has nothing to do with privacy because, as you can see, you also have to declare interest because you're accused of being biased. So there is no reason why you can't even give us the number. We are not asking for the particulars of the individuals. I'm not asking if Mr. Chen or Ms. Chen has changed his or her address so that she would move, he or she would move back to Shek Lei. I'm just asking for the numbers. So can you just give us the figures? Do you have anything to add? Well, in those cases, we know the particulars of the voters involved, but then according to legal procedures, we are actually preparing for the initial voter register for the upcoming election, and in that register, we're going to reflect the latest position. If they're eligible, then the register particulars will be reflected in the latest register. It's not about me giving you the details of the 41 cases because some of these involve criminal investigation and therefore I have to be very careful about disclosing too many details to you because I don't want to give people the wrong impression as to what the status is concerning these 41 cases. That's why I'm trying to give you as little information as possible. But then by the time when the final register is published, you can always refer to it. I hope that that could be put on record. We would like to get the information by the time when the register is published. So you would be disclosing or publishing the register, right? Yes, in the initial voter register, it will be publicized and without affecting any other criminal investigation, we'll be more than happy to provide as many details as possible. All right, next, Paul Chair. Thank you, Chairman. Allow me to say this to Dr. Kenneth Chen, because I disrupted your speech by 2 seconds. I still think it's not right. Even though it's been our practice, I think basic law is something very important. Then I couldn't help just blurting out those remarks. It's not that I don't agree with what Alvin Yeung and Kenneth Chen just said about political vetting. When it comes to the basic law, if it's an important principle which has been violated, and if you blatantly violated that, then of course the administration has the responsibility to screen it so that for remarks that are blatantly in violation of the basic law, government departments, including the Hong Kong Post, should not be involved because some of that might constitute criminal offense, whether it's criminal or civil, and therefore you will have to be very careful about political advertising. Because if you look at my past experience in running for district council elections, if a picture does not clarify the relevant parties, whether or not they belong to a particular political party, the DFJ would adopt a relatively conservative approach, asking me to be to err on the safe side so that they would be taken out before I can send out those advertisements. And as a result, I was very nervous about it, and I was also very worried whether or not I would have sufficient time because there is a time limit, as there is a deadline for sending out those materials. That's why I hope that in this day and age, given the circumstances, the DFJ should be more expeditious in processing such inquiries instead of taking some a week or so, because you should have been very quick in giving advice to determine if a particular wording is against the basic law, instead of waiting until you're very close to the deadline for sending out those materials, and as a result, the candidate's concerned was not able to make any amendment to his leaflets. Another point for improvement is, for example, in the paper, you also refer to unlawful advertising, for example, some banners and placards and so on, which have to be removed. So by the time polling takes place, you said that you have already stepped up measures to remove such illegal advertisements, but then while you're doing it, some of the consequences would be the advertising expenses. Because such removal action would incur costs, and that would also have to be declared as election advertisement expenses. But then, as far as I understand it, when you issue summonses or even fines for the removal of such offending election advertisements, you would inform them only very late. Sometimes it's even after they have declared their election expenses or you have passed or missed the deadline, and as a result they might not have been able to include that in their declaration. So you will have to do it more quickly. You must not miss the deadline. So the REO will have to be more careful about this. And next is also about the timing of certain actions. You said that on average it took you some 4.5 hours, but then in other cases it might have taken you up to 6 hours to do the counting. According to my experience, in particular for OCs or doing the counting, they only needed to use very simple technology. Even if it involves some 1,000 voters, they can come up with the result within 10 minutes, which is very accurate.
I don't understand. Now, elections is so important. You put so much resources in it, and you don't have similar facilities that employ computers. You count slowly. You have machines that can be used for counting banknotes. So why can't you improve on this half an hour that it takes? Now, Mr. Chair talked about the cost of the advertisements, the time taken. Now we need the time needs to be speeded up, and we will discuss with the DOJ to see whether we can be more efficient in dealing with the submissions of advertisement contents by the candidates. Now, on law infringing advertisements, now, and if government departments are to remove the advertisements, there would be a cost. Now, this is the responsibility of the FEHD, and there will be a bill to the candidate, sent to the candidates later. Now, it's required that the one day after the elections, 21 days, within 21 days, the bill should be sent to the candidate. Now, of course, that's quite a tight deadline, because the report has to be done within 30 days for DC elections and 60 days for legislative elections. Now, secondly, on the vote counting, now every time we try to think of new ways, for instance, using computer to enhance the efficiency of vote counting, it depends on the voting accounting procedure. If we use electronic means, would it be helpful? Now, Mr. Paul Chair mentioned that if we count the number of votes, we can use the machines that are used for counting banknotes, and there have been successful examples abroad. But in Hong Kong, it's rather different, because there's a great deal of concern about electrical election votes. We've considered that there are less votes involved for DC elections. Now, we will continue to consider this. Now, for the electrical elections, there is more difficulty, because the vote paper is larger in size, a ballot paper is larger in size, and also we borrowed the polling stations. Now, so we have limited time to furnish the premises each time. So this limits the time within which we can install the electronic system, whether it's a network or other equipment. So we will continue to explore whether there can be new scientific methods. Now, the kind of ballot counting machines, it's a very simple and small machine that can be used by the owners' corporations. It's very simple. I don't know why the owners' corporations can do it, but the government cannot. Mr. Wong Kok-hing. Thank you, Chairman. I have two questions. Now, first, I already made this point last time. For those voters, electors living in public housing estates, now earlier the administration said that letters would be sent to them. They are asked to respond. If they don't respond, the electorate identity may become may be questioned or even deleted. Now, I'm asking about these verifying measures. Those living in public housing estates, frankly speaking, they don't move lightly and they don't lightly change their addresses. You know, it's very difficult to get housing in public housing estates. So false reporting of addresses is very rare. Now, you use this method to vet the addresses is very much a nuisance. Now, I during this election, now I have received a complaint by a resident of Siusai Wan Estate on his qualification being cancelled. Now, he said to me, to my office, that he wondered why he was unable to vote. Now, what further remedial measures are you going to adopt in voter registration to identify those who have been disqualified? And you don't just issue a letter to them. Now, for many who live in public housing estates, because you are so bureaucratic, they have been disqualified. So in the new round of voter registration, how do you remedy this? And how many have been disqualified? Will you give people a report? Now, I participated in the November 22nd election now at Siusai Wan. Now, the polling station at Siusai Wan is very close to the polling station of the geographical constituency next to it. So, in fact, it's just across the street. So, very often the approaches by people go through the same roads. So the electioneering bodies are very excited and they shout the numbers. So it causes unfairness to people in different to the candidates in different constituencies. So when you identify, when you select the polling stations, you should make clear identification available so as not to cause confusion and unfairness. On the first issue of verification of electors, now this has been discussed a number of times. Now, on the verification of electors, we adopt a pragmatic approach. Now, there are over 3 million electors and over half live in public housing estates, and there the government departments concerned make available their information system to us for vetting, but The purpose of our vetting is not to disqualify electors, but to update where there is an error. Now, for the electors living in public housing estates, before we do the verification, we usually contact them by phone if they ever gave us our phone number. If that's not possible, then we will issue a letter of inquiry. Now, if they haven't responded to our letter of inquiry, and if we put them on a list of name list for disqualification, we further issue a letter to them telling them that this elector status can be reinstated. So only when we are unable to contact them will we disqualify them. Now, for electors living in the public housing estate, it's not a random check. We, in every case, we verify with the housing department. If only when their names are not on the list of tenants will we do the verification. Now, even if there is no information on that person in the list of tenants, he may be living in that unit. So there is nothing in election laws that one has to be on the list of tenants before he can be a registered voter. Now, but we have to verify it. If he is not on the list of tenants, we have to verify that he does live in the unit so that we can keep him qualified. Now, for the Shusai Wan constituency, now in the November elections last year, there were a small number of constituencies where the constituencies were small and it's difficult to identify suitable polling stations, and it may be that the two polling stations are quite near to each other. So we will try to put up more signboards in the future, and we will try to remind the polling stations that people might go to the wrong polling station. So the staff there will direct people to the right polling station. Now, I hope members can understand that there are 431 constituencies. It's about 19,000 people per constituency. It's very small. Half a public housing estate would be a constituency already. Can you answer me now, how many residents of public housing estates have been disqualified? Time is up. Can you answer briefly, please? I may not have the accurate information on hand, but taking the 2015 voter registration cycle, we have done about 15,000 inquiries, and 40-odd have been removed. Now, disqualified. Now, most of them live in public housing estate. 40,000 public housing residents have been disqualified. That's a quite a large number. So you must do the remedial work. You must identify them and qualify them once again. That's a lot of unfairness. It's not 40-odd thousand. Now, most of them live in public housing estates. Now, these are, most of them are not in the list of tenants of the housing association. So if they don't respond to us, it's very difficult to keep them qualified. This is a bureaucratic approach, so they become disqualified. We will try to do more in publicity. We have one more item for agenda. We have only 45 minutes left. So I will not allow more questions. We come to item number four. Next item, the proposed guidelines on election-related activities in respect of electoral election issued by the EAC. You have the public consultation document, and then there are two more documents, 1085(05), and then there's the document 06, which is the background brief by the secretariat. Under secretary, please. Now, the EAC and the REO are now doing the preparation for the electoral election in September this year, and the EAC has proposed guidelines changes, and they are undertaking the public consultation, and the document has shown the major amendments compared to the previous election. So I asked Mr. Lee to take us to the document. Now, the new general election will take place on 4th of September. On March the 3rd, a set of election guidelines have been issued to seek the public's views. Simple language is used. There are new measures and procedures.
So we would like to conduct the election in a fair and equal manner. That's why we conducted this consultation. It will end on the 1st of April. So members of the public are welcome to give their views to the EAC. And last week, on the 17th of March, there was a public consultation forum to listen to views from the public. And under the proposed guidelines, basically, that's based on the existing guideline, and necessary amendments have been made. And there are two main types of amendments. Number one is to reflect the latest position of the law, as at since the last election, whatever legal amendments have been made would also be incorporated into the latest guidelines. We have already set out in clear terms in order to facilitate the understanding by the candidates so that they can find it easier to comply with. So that will be under the ambit of the relevant law enforcement agencies, and the EAC has already discussed with the relevant law enforcement agencies so that there would be more elaboration in the guideline for the candidates. Next, there are certain election arrangements outside of the law, and this is mainly to reflect or update the latest position, and we also hope that the wording in the guideline would be clearer so as to align it with other electoral guidelines. In fact, during the DC election electioneering guideline, we have already made the relevant amendments, and all the guidelines are set out in the annex. Please note that other than the legal changes, the updated guidelines have also provided further details on this. First, with regard to election advertising, in publishing the relevant materials, you will have to comply with certain requirements. In particular, if the candidates or the organizations are sending out messages relating to the election, calling upon the candidate to vote or not vote for particular candidates, or to vote for certain representatives representing certain organizations, and if they can point to a particular candidate, then that would be regarded as electoral advertisements, and the candidates would also have to be very careful about the relevant legal requirements. And also on Chapter 9, on electioneering activities, we have also updated the further guidelines by the EOC so that if the candidate or the voter should not be furnishing their details to the candidate or their agents, certain security measures will have to be adopted in order to ensure that the particulars would not be misused. And also for chairman or office bearers of building organizations, they must not abuse their positions in the organizations to give unfair treatment to any candidate in the conduct of electioneering or canvassing activities in the buildings concerned, especially when, for example, the office bearers themselves are candidates in the election. So they will have to be extra careful about the possible conflict of interest. Chapter 11, Election Broadcasting, Media Reporting and Election Forums, it emphasizes that there should be fair and equal treatment in producing and conducting election-related and news reporting programs, and in no circumstance should any broadcaster offer unfair publicity to any particular candidate or list of candidates, or else they might be breaching the relevant legislation and also advertising expenses. Chapter 15 is about the exit poll, and it updated the administrative procedures in approving the application for the conduct of exit polls and the enhanced measures to be adopted to ensure this, and a statutory declaration will have to be made. Chapter 16, Election Expenses and Election Donations. The guidelines remind candidates of the need of apportionment of expenses between election-related purposes and any other purposes, so as to set out very clearly as to which part is related to the election. It also reminds the candidates that in soliciting, accepting donations and so on, they should adopt good practices in order to set out very clearly as to what the donation is used for in order to avoid disputes. During the consultation period, we have made reference to the views collected and will finalize that. We expect that by the end of June, we would be issuing the guidelines formally. So that's all I'd like to say for the time being. Any questions? Three, for the time being, I read out the names. Alice Mack, Raymond Wong, Wong Kwok Heng, Alvin Yeung. Anyone else? All right, four in total. Poll Chair two, so five in total. 4 minutes each. Alice Mack, Chairman, is about election forums. It says that every attending candidate or the list of candidates will have to be given equal time in the relevant part so that they can declare or they can also state their election manifesto. What does that mean? Because for election forums, every candidate in any part of it should be given equal time. So you talk about the relevant parts. Does that mean that in the forum, let's say there are 10 lists and everybody will have 10, will have 2 minutes, and after they have stated their election manifesto or platform, then the host of the program will be free to use whatever time is left, and as a result, they might not be given equal time in answering questions. Would that be the case, Mr. Lee? Yes, Chairman. Well, for election forums, the guiding principle is that it has to be fair and equal to all the candidates. The principle has never been changed. And it's also mentioned whether or not they should be given equal time throughout the program. Well, we have taken account past experience, and the relevant broadcasters have also told us their experience, because every program would have different arrangements or design. And therefore, if you just rigidly that throughout the program, every candidate will be given equal time, it may not be the best practice. That's why what we are saying is that in any case, if we receive a complaint, then we would adopt that approach or that principle, that is the fairness and equality approach in screening such complaints. But then in every part, the candidate will be allowed time to introduce their platform. And we believe that if that is the design, so that every candidate will have equal time to introduce their platform, and that time will have to be equal, so that every candidate will have a reasonable time to introduce their own platform. But then for other parts, there might be different designs. And if it's rigidly provided that every candidate will have to speak up to a particular duration of time, then it may not be appropriate, because some candidates might be less worthy, others will be very eloquent, and therefore it depends on the design of the program. In any case, we will have to look at it in its totality. And if there are complaints, then we would not be saying that, okay, because you have not spoken enough time. We would look at whether or not the program host or the program has dealt with each and every candidate fairly and equally. Ms. Alice Mack, I think there are problems. You said you would only act upon receipt of complaints to see if the program has been fair and equal to each and every candidate. But then that has already taken place, so you would only be taking action afterwards. So how can that be fair? Because you have been criticized for not being fair to the candidates, because you would only wait till after there are complaints. So however hard you try to rectify the problem, it has already taken place. And there are some candidates who might be very eloquent, others who might not be able to express themselves very clearly. And if you do not specifically provide for the for equal time to be given to each and every candidate, it will not be fair to those who are not able to express themselves clearly. So how can you be sure that you are fair and equal to every candidate? What's the problem of giving equal time to each candidate? How difficult would it be to do it? And if you just leave it to the host to decide if it's fair and equal, then that would be very arbitrary. So it would be controversial. And there are no justifications. All right, the host might think that I've been very fair to him already, but then this guy is not talkative, but then that guy is more talkative, then that might not be fair. In particular, for those who are not able to fight for more time for himself, and then after receiving complaint, you might claim to be very fair, but then that would already be too late. So there is no objective threshold to determine if it's fair, and therefore, if they are given equal time, then I think that would be the most equal way or most the fairest way to deal with it. Mr. Lee, let me supplement. Concerning media organizations organizing such forums, we have some guidelines for the broadcasters or media agencies to follow. And if we receive complaints, if the complaints are substantiated and the nature of the complaint is serious, then we would issue reprimand to the broadcasters or media agencies so that they would understand their role, and therefore there would not be grossly unfair situation to the candidates. And if we have to be fair and equal to every candidate, well, basically that's the principle. Unless the part of the program is very special, basically you will have to give more or less the same time to each candidate. So they have done such forums before, and the design would be giving equal time to each candidate. But then if you rigidly say that, well, for every part, every candidate will have to be given equal time, and if a candidate cannot speak up to that time, then that would also pose some problems for the program host. Because if there is dead air, then that's also not desirable. So I believe that we can only set out the principles very clearly, but then in the course of actual implementation, we can see that most media agencies have followed that through by giving each candidate equal time. Raymond Wong, Chairman, with regard to this proposed guideline on election-related activities in respect of electoral election, all right, this will be used this year. Many of them are road guidelines. Some have been updated, and this is very thick, and we've only been given very short time to go through it, and we've only got several minutes for questions and answers, so it's not very meaningful. But still, well, setting aside the details of the guideline, first, on election-related activities that happened in the past. All right, is the REO trying to conduct political vetting? Are you trying to impose no-go zones for them? Because the Hong Kong Post would be sending out free postages, but then you are saying that certain issues or items or messages cannot go into the households. And Mr. Leung Tin Kei, one of the candidates in the NTE's by-election, was banned from sending out certain materials. So you are actually setting up no-go zones when it comes to freedom of speech. Have you asked the DFJ for advice on this? So you will have to answer my question. So have you sought the advice from your superiors? Or is it that you just act arbitrarily? All right, over 500,000 of those leaflets cannot go into the households. So how can that be fair and equal? He should have been elected. So he only managed to get 66,000 votes. You're talking about 500,000 leaflets. Have you considered the impact on the candidates by not allowing him to send out the messages? You should have been a technocrat. And yet you're trying to engage in political vetting, and you're trying to set up no-go zones. Why is it that they are not allowed to say anything about autonomy and founding our own nation? I'm sure there'll be further challenges under the Basic Law. I remember in 2010, we also talked about a de facto referendum and also everybody rising up against the government. And if you did the same back then, some of the messages would not have been able to be sent out. Mr. Wong, we are talking about the next item already. we are on electoral election. So what I was asking him, about the Leung Tin K case. And Apple Daily's election advertisements for a number of days, they've been promoting or advocating a particular candidate, and Wen Wei Ta Gong have been doing very much the same. So that should have been counted as advertisements. And yet they also said that for Passion Times, we have also advocated or promoted a particular candidate. We have made it very clear that these are election advertisements. But what about Apple Daily? All right, Alvin Yeung was given a front page coverage. He looks handsome, that's it. But then that is about an election. So you have done so excessively. What are the criteria? You're just bullying the weak. By currying favor of those who are in power. So, well, you said that if there are complaints, then you would take it up. But then every time it happens, all right, in 2012, the same thing happened. All right, Lai Chi-ying also wrote an article saying that I accepted money from the Chinese Communist Party in order to ruin the pandemic.
And now you cause trouble to the netizens. You go too far. Now they put up a photo showing the head and okay, your time is up. Mr. Lee, please respond briefly because you responded to some extent early on. You have to give me an answer. You have used up your time. You have plenty of time. Apple Daily, that's election advertisement. Ta Kong and Wen Wei Pao. No need to repeat. Yeah. Mr. Lee, let me respond very briefly. Firstly, the so-called vetting. Now, as I said, as I explained, now the REO is an administrative body. I am a technocrat. So I have no political stance. As I explained very clearly, it's just that we received opinion from the Department of Justice. We sought legal opinion from DOJ. Why did you seek such opinion? It occurs all the time. You try to figure out what the superiors want. Please don't interrupt. We can't conduct in a meeting this way. You have, must let me speak. It's a very important question. Why did you seek a view from the DOJ? Please do not interject again, Mr. Lee. Now, if we think there's a problem with the content, it's our usual approach to seek opinion from DOJ. So we base our considerations on the DOJ opinion. Now, the advertisements includes a lot of contents. Now, there some allegation on what these so-called advertisements involve. Now, we would let the department's concern take care of this. Now, we will act according to the law and let the law enforcement agency consider whether these are election advertisements. And then there are statutory requirements on how the costs should be dealt with. So this is not something to be followed up by the REO or EAC, but this is to be followed up according to law. Now, please, you have followed the order, please. Are there other people in the line? Mr. Wong Kwok Heng, I have two questions for the administration. First, I'd like to follow up on the last item of agenda. I request that the REO, since you have spent public money to disqualify over 40,000 public housing residents. Now, for the upcoming elections, you should make this up. You should make up for this. Now, for these 40-odd thousand residents who on whom you have the phone numbers and addresses and whom you have disqualified, now you have to approach them before the 2nd of May to get them to register. If you don't, you are derelict in your duty, you are unfair and unjust in robbing them of their civil rights, and this would be unfair to them. I will follow this up when we discuss the budget. You should use your resources to approach these residents to make up for what you did. My second question is that Ms. Alice Mack pointed out just now that in upcoming elections, whether it's legislative or DC elections, there's an issue of fairness. Now, in your detailed regulations, you should confirm. Now, when the candidates during the forums tell people about their platform, or when they respond to questions, they should be provided with equal time. Now, because this is about the principle of fairness, if the REO says that it's up to the moderator to decide, or it's up to the media to decide, now the public may think, may not want to have certain gaps in the program. Now, I think that would be unfair, because you are not affording everyone the same right to be elected. Now, in your response to Ms. Alice Mack, I think you are in fact laying time bombs for the upcoming legislative elections. On the second question, I tried to explain what's the stance of the REO of the EAC. I will forward Mr. Wong Kok-hing's views to the EAC, and his views will be taken into account, and EAC will decide whether an adjustment has to be made. Now, on the qualifications of PRH residents, as I said, we will do our best to engage in more publicity so that people who were disqualified can apply again to be qualified. Now, I'd just like to explain that for those public housing residents who were disqualified, most of them were not on the list of tenants. And when we disqualified them, we had tried to contact them. So we do not have a definite means to contact them again, because our past attempts were unsuccessful. So if people want to be electors, they should review whether the information on record is correct. If they are not registered, they should apply again. If you are not on the register, then you are not qualified. That is a wrong concept. Now, if one has submitted false information, you should launch a criminal prosecution. Now, you shouldn't query whether they are qualified just because they are not on the list of tenants. Now, I haven't seen even one case where a resident of public rental housing falsely reported his address or his qualification as an elector. Now, you have disqualified over 40,000 public housing residents. Now, there's no time for you to answer, but I strongly request that in the coming a voter registration exercise, you should approach each of these households and try to make up for what you did. I think this question has been raised and has been answered. Next one, Mr. Alvin Yeung. Thank you, Chairman. I'd just like to follow up on free mailing. Now, I'd like the administration to tell the Hong Kong people what is the objective standard. Now, when will you make a take a document submitted by a candidate to the DOJ? Now, there are two possible cases where this might occur. First, when we have to collate the introductions to candidates, and then secondly, the free mail service for candidates. In both cases, the candidates have to submit samples to us. We will not undertake political vetting, but the contents must be legal. Now, if we know that there might be illegal content, then we will turn it over to the Department of Justice. So, not every document submitted to you by the candidate will be turned over to the DOJ. So you will exercise your discretionary power to decide what will be submitted to the DOJ. That should be clear. Chairman, I think Mr. Lee knows how to answer. Thank you. That is not you yourself, but I think the administration will do the vetting first. And what's your standard? How do you determine what is legal? Please clarify, Mr. Lee. Now, a process is involved, but I'd like to respond that ultimately it depends on the legal opinion. So whether there is discretionary power or not, the ultimate arrangement will be based on the legal opinion by the DOJ. I know that. I don't want to make things difficult for you. I just want to make clear to future candidates when is the document submitted to the DOJ, because it takes time for the DOJ to do the vetting. Now, the free piece of mailing material, now there is a cut-off date. If you only give the response to the candidate a couple of days before the cut-off date, he doesn't have time to make the amendment. We know there is difficulty with the time. Now, as an administrative department, we try to complete the work as quickly as possible and forward the opinion to the candidate. Now, as I said, after the confirmation of the voter of the names of candidates, we have to act as quickly as possible. So after nomination, after the candidates have been confirmed, then when you receive the draft of the document, can you allow enough time so that the candidate has enough time to do any amendment if necessary? The earlier the candidate submits the document or the draft, the earlier we can do the review. Now, is there administrative guideline so that you can tell the candidate you can provide the information to the candidate by a certain time so that there is time to make amendment? Now, if the contents are not, even if they are not that long, the DOJ will have to take a certain period of time to study the material. Now, if you give the material back to the candidate too late, they don't have enough time to make amendment. Paul Che. Firstly, I agree with Mr. Wong Kwok Heng. Now, if we use the public housing data for verification, this is discriminatory because you don't have the same approach towards residents of private housing. So you shouldn't do this vetting for public housing residents. hope you will review this. And also, on Mr. Raymond Wong's point, now, there are many guidelines which give people the feeling that you punish those who abide by the rules, but you condone or make things easy for those who do a lot of advertisement on a large scale, just because the advertisements are of a large scale and cost lots of money. Now, in the UK, they have a relatively more relaxed approach. Within a certain, during a certain period of time before the elections, even if for advertisements that appear to be election related, they will be considered as such. Now, so if you do need to impose restrictions, now I don't think there should be limitations on advertisements, because this is a socialist approach. In more advanced democracies, they don't have such restrictions. For instance, it's not found in Japan, US, or Taiwan. Now, you always say that, well, we won't make the change, there's not enough time.
I'd like to make use of my limited time to ask this question. All right. With regard to internet advertisements, well, you've got several paragraphs on this. Well, my understanding is that so long as you can meet one of the requirements under A2E, so that where there is a hyperlink, then you can resolve all the problems involved, so that you don't have to look at the technical issues, because this is somewhat controversial. So can you do a little more work on that, or can you give us more details as to under what circumstances internet or social platforms can be made use of for advertising purposes, and under what circumstances would it be regarded as going overboard? Because in some cases, it's not very clear. For example, for election advertising, well, you talk about the intention of the person involved. If it's not for promoting or downgrading a particular candidate, it's okay. But then if the intention is otherwise, then that would be considered differently. But then how would you know the intention of a particular netizen when he posts certain posts on the net? So how can you verify his intention? So can you just say that, alright, for the law-abiding people, you can regulate them, but then for those who blatantly flout the law, then they might just do it first, whatever the consequence may be. So that would be unfair to the law-abiding ones, and you will be favoring those who blatantly flout the rules. Alright, please grasp the time. We only have 12 minutes to go. And there are still three who have yet to ask their questions, and we will have to hand over the room by 4:30. So please be brief and concise. Yes, I'll try my best, Chairman. Since 2012, we amended the law, and we have provided a central platform for the candidates to announce their election advertisements. In the past, we didn't have that. So if in certain social media or network, if they put up advertisements, then it's very hard for them to print that out and submit it to the REO. That's why we have issued the latest guideline, because the trend is that there are many people who make use of the internet to publicize their advertisements. And Mr. Paul Chair was asking in what circumstances can they enclose a hyperlink. In fact, there is a rule on this. If the particular platform is an interactive one, so that there would be exchange of information through an interactive platform, then they can then put this link on that platform in announcing the election advertisement so that the public can inspect them. If you require them to print out everything, then there would be practical difficulty. That's why the provision of a central platform is to target such activities. And second, sorry, Chairman, I forgot the second, part two. All right, next, Daniel Kwok. Chairman, my question is very simple. My question is, what's the advice from DOJ? About what? You said that the DOJ gave you some advice on election advertisements. So what's the advice? Mr. Lee, I can only summarize it. The DOJ's advice was that the relevant content might constitute an illegal act on the part of the candidate because the candidate, in submitting the nomination list, he has already made a declaration that he will have to uphold the basic law. So that summarizes the advice from the DOJ. But then can you give us more details about the DOJ's advice? The reason why I ask this because I'm considering public interest because there are many candidates who need to know when you will be throwing his material to the DOJ and how the DOJ would be analyzing his publicity material in making a ruling or giving an advice saying that he has breached the basic law. And the reason why is ambiguous, that's because you are not disclosing the details of the advice. You just summarized it. It's not going to help. So can you give us more details or can you give us a paper to elaborate on the advice from the DOJ? Because there is no legal privilege involved. Because this advice would be something that the entire community in Hong Kong would like to see it. And there is no legal privacy involved whatsoever. Mr. Lee, well, I understand the request by Mr. Kwok, but then usually when the DOJ gives any advice, in general circumstances, we would not be disclosing it. But then that's not going to help if you just summarize it and you said that they are saying this or that. But then on what basis or according to what logic have they said that this would be against the basic law? And if you do not elaborate on that, then nobody would have any good idea as to why they say that it's against the basic law. If you claim legal privilege, I think you're just wasting taxpayers' money and you're using taxpayers' money to get a piece of legal advice. Why can't we read it? Because you will help future candidates in making their arrangements. Do you understand what I mean? I understand. So why can't you disclose it? Well, as to whether or not it should be disclosed, it's not up to me. Who makes the decision? Basically, this is a legal advice. And if Mr. Dennis Kwok has this suggestion, then I can refer this to the DOJ. And then it's for them to decide whether they can tell us more about the legal analysis behind this. So you'll be submitting a more detailed paper setting out the DOJ's legal advice, its justifications, and its line of thought, right? At the same time, I would also like to point out that I understand that the relevant candidates have also said that they might file judicial reviews, and that would make the whole thing somewhat more complicated. But then in any case, I promise that I'll pass this on to the DOJ for consideration. That's the suggestion by Mr. Dennis Kwok. Well, even if there are judicial reviews, it's not justification for you not to divulge the details, because even in judicial review cases, you will have to explain why you have done this and why you have given this advice. So this is not a reason why you refuse to disclose. Well, Mr. Kwok, I'm not a lawyer, and therefore it's not for me to say. So when can you give us a reply as to when you can disclose it? I can only promise that I'll do it as soon as possible. When? Well, I'm not able to answer now. I'll have to go back and discuss with the DOJ whether it's possible and when we can do it. There is one more point that I'd like to take up. That is in the annex, there is a paper, all right, para 8.4, saying that you would be advising the candidates as to how they can use the net. Do you understand how they use Facebook these days? All right, if I'm running in the election, and there might be someone who doesn't know me, and then he opened an account saying that he would support Dennis Kwok, and I do not know that guy, and there is no way that I can contact him, then what should I do? You say that you're reminding the candidates, and they have to follow certain rules and so on. So how am I going to follow? Well, in briefing members on the guidelines, I said that there are two main parts. One, we would be explaining some legal rules and so on. So these are the legal requirements, not something coming out from the EAC. And there are others which have nothing to do with the law. So Mr. Kwok was referring to 8.3, 8.4. So under what circumstances would that be taken as an election advertisement? So that's regulated under the ECICO. And the law also provides for certain things that would be allowed or permitted. So it's not something coming out from the EAC. What we are saying is that according to our past experience, the EAC would be working closely with other law enforcement agencies, and we have looked at the legal provisions and we try to elaborate a bit on that to help the candidates to understand the provisions better. So as to whether you follow the guidelines, well, all right, if you follow the guidelines, then we believe that it's safer and better. But then if you do not follow, then will it constitute a breach of the law? Then it's not for us to say, it's for the law enforcement agency to say. So there is a distinction between this, and therefore for 8.3, 8.4, according to our past experience, we have talked to the ICAC, because the ICAC is the law enforcement agency in this case, and we noticed that in the internet, we have tried to find out the activity ecology these days. And as you might have noticed, in 8.3, 8.4, we have said that if you're just expressing your opinion and there is no intention whatsoever, and there is no evidence to suggest that you have a particular intention, then the enforcement agencies would not be taking up prosecution lightly. So we are just elaborating here that you would not be caught up on the wrong side of the law inadvertently. We believe that this represents an improvement. But then at the same time, if people are trying to make use of the loophole in the law or trying to do something, all right, I'm not naming names, but then I might be engaging in some activities directly or indirectly in promoting a particular candidate, breaching the definition of advertisement under the ECICO, then he might be breaching the law. That's all. Next, Lee Chek-yen. Chairman, I would also like to ask a question about internet advertisements. So the problem is not with the candidates themselves. The problem is any member of the public can just surf the web, and he might ask voters to vote for a particular candidate or not vote for a particular candidate. Okay, here it says that the relevant parties have been reminded that this might incur election advertisement expenses. All right, on the internet, there might be a monthly subscription fee. But then if you just post something on Facebook, it's free of charge. So there is no election expenses incurred whatsoever. All right, of course, if you post something, and on average, if you post, say, 1,000 posts, and then you're doing 100 times a day, and therefore it would account for 1/10 of your monthly expenses. Well, that would be rather annoying, because you're talking about several million net servers these days, and even if you remind them, it's not going to work. But then it's under the law, so the problem is, theoretically, you can still enforce the law. And there is another scenario, that is, well, if you ask people to vote for a particular candidate, that's very clear, you're supporting that candidate. But then that candidate does not know it. For example, if I say I support Alvin Yeung, Alvin Yeung has not authorized me to do it. But then what is going to happen? Does it mean that he'll incur expenses for that? All right, I'm not supporting Alvin Yeung. I'm asking people to vote him out. Then that might involve the other six candidates, because all the other six candidates don't want Alvin Yeung to be elected. So whose election expenses should it be attributed to? So it would be hard to enforce. If it's hard to enforce, then why don't you just make it clear? All right, it's not enforceable. All right, I will only be regulating the candidates, and if the candidates use the internet to put up advertisements, then of course they'll be subject to the regulation. But then for the rest of the community, basically, there is no way that you can regulate it in order not to cause any undue disturbance to the public. All right, I can also give you some examples. For example, if we put up some false information on the net, for example, Wikipedia, he can come up with some false particular or false particulars and information. All right, if he makes up the number and then he asks voters to vote for a particular number and so on. I think Lee Chek-yen made a point, and it's really difficult to deal with. So Mr. Lee, have you considered that? Chairman, I'll try to say a few words on that. Well, Mr. Lee Chek-yen made a very important point. That is about Hong Kong's electoral arrangements. All right, in overseas countries, they have different examples. But then in Hong Kong, we are somewhat different in the sense that when we try to uphold fair and equal election, we will control the expenses, and there is a limit. So it's not just about the direct expenses incurred by the candidates. If other people, in order to promote this candidate or prevent him from being elected, incur expenses to engage in positive or negative advertising, then that would also be counted towards the candidate's election expenses. Unless we change the system, if you think that this is not sustainable or we want to change it, then of course there is room for discussion. But then it's about the arrangement under the current system. And also under the ECICO, what's the definition? Because that is very broadly defined. For election expenses, whoever incurs the expenses resulting in a particular candidate being elected or not elected, then that would already be covered. And of course, the merit of it is that whatever this candidate spends, if he asks someone else to do the advertisement for him, this will not be allowed. But then under 8.4, in para 8.4, if you do not have that intention, if I'm just talking to my family, asking them to support a particular candidate, or if I'm just chatting with a particular friend in the social forum, then that would not be counted. But then in Facebook, I might have 1,000 friends, but then I can just post without being charged. Unless you say that, all right, that would also be counted. All right, I ask you a question. So does that mean that you will have to apportion the fee? For example, if I post 1,000 messages every month, and then if I posted 100, then you would count it as 1/10 of the monthly fee that I pay? Well, Chairman, I understand this, but then this is another question. The most important thing is whatever you pay for serving the net. If you have an intention to promote a particular candidate, then even if it's just 10 cents, it's still against the law. Because this is an election expenditure without the consent of the candidate, and if you incur that expense, then that would be against the law already. The thing is, the current arrangement has the merit in a sense that everybody would be subject to the same expense limit. But then if it's so broadly defined, all right, if in our remarks, if I refer to a particular candidate, if I say that one candidate is better than another candidate, then you don't really need to worry about this, because in para 8.4 of the guidelines, if it's pure discussion, whether it's on Facebook or social platforms, if you're just discussing that pragmatically, if you're just chatting honestly with one another about a particular candidate, then that would not constitute advertisements.
Your time is up. But there's an issue. Now, I kept a photo. I tried to promote a person. I used my account, and I call upon people to go on the internet. So there's no innovation. So you include that as well. You treat it as advertisement. Sometimes it's not done by the candidate. That makes it difficult. Now, originally, the meeting is supposed to end at 4:30. Anne Chang has raised her hand, so I will let her speak as well, and then we will end the meeting. And we are short of, and the other panel is short of members. Anne Chang, now on election forums, the question was asked, fair and equal treatment. Now, as long as the broadcasting medium has not breached the original intention, then they don't have to provide equal time to candidates. Now, I think the organizations have to make it clear. Can you give a concrete example, Mr. Lee? I believe Ms. Chen wants me to give an example. Yes? In what circumstances only certain candidates can answer, but others do not have to answer? Now, there are many forms of election fora. Now, In the guidelines, we point out that if there's a certain part in the forum for each candidate to state his platform, that platform must provide equal time. Now, on other segments of the forum, it depends on the design of the forum. If the members ask, of the candidates ask questions to each other, then that would be different. So we there is no across the board treatment. Now, recently in New Territories East by elections, some radio stations organized these forums, and they abided by equal treatment principle even during mutual question time. Time is kept, and it's kept quite strictly. So everyone wishes the elections to be conducted fairly. So taking New Territories East by elections as an example, it would appear that basically they abide by the principle of equal treatment to candidates. But in that by election, they give equal time. But here you say that you do not have to provide equal time to each candidate. So how? So can you give an example of unequal time? Now, we have to be fair and equal in our treatment of candidates. Now, so they must not design a program which gives one candidate more time and less time to other candidate. Now, so overall, the time has to be equal. The total time has to be provided, divided equally among different candidates. So they sometimes they need more flexibility to design the program. I see. So the total time has to be the same for each candidate, but in some segments, some candidates wish to provide longer answers, the other candidates can answer more briefly, but they can speak longer in other segments. I see. Now, on election advertisement expenses, now during each elections, we see some candidates, suppose they have been providing service in their districts. Now, during elections, they continue to publicize their work in the district, and they didn't say that please ask people to support them or to vote for them. So in that case, they don't have to include that in the advertisement expense or in advertisement in election expense or election advertisement. Now, the intention is to promote the candidate in an election. Now, so we have to identify whether he is providing a service as an existing as an incumbent councillor, or whether he is actually trying to promote himself as a candidate. Now, if there is proof that he is providing a service to promote his own candidacy, then that causes suspicion that they it may constitute an electioneering activity, and it may constitute an election expense. Mr. Lee Chuk-yang, Mr. Alvin Yeung asked that there could be another meeting to discuss the loss of key to ballot box. We discussed that already. You were not here just now. He should have understood what's being talked about. Now, we can also talk about this at the next meeting, because next time we'll also be talking about electoral elections. Sometimes I understood the comment, so I made the answer on behalf of the administration. Now, a couple of points on election advertisements. Please rethink that. Now, in the New Territories East by election, some well-known personality wrote some article to promote a candidate. Now, the candidate might not even be aware of it, but would that be an election advertisement? How do you treat that? And a media boss in his own media publicizes his support for a candidate. How do you regard that? Now, in the upcoming general elections, you have to clarify this. You have to follow up this, or there might be more instances. Also, say on the internet, all kinds of messages are released on the internet, a lot of it irresponsibly. Now, if you don't think of some way to restrict that, more and more people might use of that means. They might spread some false news or information to affect a certain candidate or the election outcome. Now, have you received such complaints? And if you receive such complaints, how can it be regulated? Now, please give some thought to that. Now, item 5, AOB, I don't think so. Next meeting, 18th of April, 2:30 p.m. Thank you.